Sunday that's designated Life Sunday every year, and that's the reason for the picture, colorful picture of the beautiful baby on the back of your worship bulletins. This is 50 years since the Supreme Court decided that in Roe versus Wade that it did not have the responsibility of protecting life before it is born. And so we have dealt with the problem of when does life begin and how precious is life from its beginning to its very end. We certainly have not heard the end of that argument, even though the Supreme Court has thrown that back to the states, certainly in New York State that is a hot button. So we just want to affirm that God gave life and we respect that life for all of its natural course. Announcements. Next Sunday is our annual meeting. For the first time since the COVID pandemic, we are going to return to making it a fellowship event. So it will not be held here in the church as it's been for the past couple of years. After service next week, we'll be going back to the multi-purpose room. We'll have a luncheon that is a bring a dish to pass in addition to the beef on whack that will be provided as beverages. So bring something, it doesn't have to be elaborate. Could be store-bought, doesn't have to be homemade. The idea is we want to get together and have some fellowship and then discuss the ministry's past and future of our plans here at Trinity. The fundraising event, Coldest Night of the Year, is something that Lockport Cares Homeless Shelter is running. And that's going to take place on February the 25th, the last Saturday of February. It is a walk-a-thon, and so I think we're familiar with how walk-a-thons work. People volunteer to walk and get sponsors, and all of the money for that walk will go towards supporting the efforts of Lockport Cares Homeless Shelter to provide warmth for people in need. Please see Jane Trombley. Jane has just walked in. She is our team leader for Trinity's group called the Trinity Trotters. And we're looking for walkers and we're looking for people to sponsor those walkers. So please talk to Jane about that. Just want to throw in a little teaser for our Bible study. We do a Monday evening Bible study here at Trinity. And currently we're studying the Gospel of John. And we've gotten up to chapter 6 of the Gospel of John. And this is where it gets pretty interesting as Jesus becomes controversial, not to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, but to his own followers. Jesus starts saying some things that even his own disciples start saying, I don't know if we can follow this man if he's going to say those types of things. So we'll find out at Bible study, what are these things that Jesus says that are so controversial that it makes his own disciples wonder if they should follow him? In our prayers, we're praying for Jean Beam. Jean is now at Niagara Hospice House, so we pray for her. And we also pray for the family and friends of Malcolm Watson. Yeah. Malcolm was a member of our congregation. He lived on John Street. He passed away this past week. His funeral will be right here at Trinity on Tuesday morning at 10 a.m. Let us now stand as we begin our worship, singing hymn 826, Hark the Voice of Jesus Christ. draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, poor and miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve the temporal and eternal punishment. But I am sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of your holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death, of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before you.
For he shall belong to the Lord, and he rules over the nations.
Posterity shall serve him. It shall be told of the Lord in the coming generation.
They shall proclaim the righteousness to a people yet unborn that he has done.
Thank you.
The Old Testament reading for the third Sunday after the Epiphany is from Isaiah, the first, or chapter 9. There will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you with joy as at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Before we sing the psalm, I would like to ask the children to come up, if you would come forward for a special message just for you. Children. So what is it I have in my hand? A candle. Now why do we have candles in church? Well, we've got lights. We've got all the light we need. I think these lights, these candles really are necessary for life. But they do remind us of something very special. And that is, Jesus is the light of the world. I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same judgment. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there is quarreling among you, my brothers. What I mean is that each one of you says, I follow Paul, or I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas, or I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one may say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the house of Stephanus, but beyond that I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
We stand as we sing the Hallelujahs.
Thank you.
text for the sermon this morning is from the gospel reading from Matthew chapter 4, which tells us the beginning of Jesus' ministry among us. If you were to describe the Christian life in just a single word, what word would you choose? Well, I've given some thought, of course, to this in advance, so I've come up with a few words that might seem fitting to different people. Some people might say, holiness describes the Christian life. And as you read the words of Jesus, you find that he does call us to be holy. As a matter of fact, he says, you should be holy just as my heavenly Father and I are holy. And so that is the ideal goal for all of us. We should be pure in our thinking, pure in our speech. We should be holy and righteous in our conduct at all times. And many have tried to walk that walk, and all but Jesus have failed. We know the law of God. We know it's holy. We know that it serves as a guide for our holy living as the redeemed people of Christ. We just are not capable of keeping God's law holy. And so if our active holiness is the definition of the Christian life, then we're all in trouble because we're not good enough. All right, so let's leave holiness aside for the moment. Let's say love would be the word that really describes the Christian life. Because yes, the Christian life is built on love, specifically on that type of love the Bible calls agape love, kind of love that God has for us. And of course, we love because God first loved us, right? But honestly, our pure and selfless love is often mixed with other kinds of love. We simultaneously have the love of self, the love of excitement, the love of things, the love of attention. So once our selfless love is adulterated like that, it's never going to be the hallmark of our Christian life. All right, so let's set that word aside also. If holiness doesn't completely describe us and love does not completely describe our walk, how about striving? We realize we're not Jesus, we're sinners, and he came to save, but he's paid for our sins and he's given us a new lease on life. So maybe the mark of Christian living is that we are striving for love and for holiness. We're modeling ourselves after Jesus. And even if we do fall short, we can be measured on how hard we've tried, how close we've come to walking the walk and following Jesus. Once again, though, what measure do we have to decide whether we made a good enough attempt to walk hand in hand with the Lord? We could measure ourselves against the 12 disciples, I suppose. And we'd probably even be encouraged if we did that, because time after time we read, the disciples doubted, they stumbled, at times they outright denied Jesus, all of them ran away in the Garden of Gethsemane. And Jesus let them know time and again how disappointing they could be. But Jesus loved them. He said it was not for their striving that he loved them, but for the fact that he had chosen them. So I'm not going to use any of those words to perfectly describe the Christian life, holiness, love, or striving. I'm going to choose a word that Jesus uses at the very beginning of his public ministry. And that was our gospel reading this morning. Remember that in his ministry, it didn't yet become public until after he was baptized, and the Father was the one that did the speaking at that point. It didn't become public until after the 40 days of temptation and fasting, when he shooed away the devil by quoting words of Scripture. But after that, when he began to preach in public, Jesus began with his mission statement. It is Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And so because Jesus is the center of our Christian faith, and what he says and what he does should be central to what his followers say and do, and Jesus reveals his primary purpose for living in hand among us, I'm going to choose the word repentance as emblematic of what the Christian life is all about. So what is repentance? Repentance is, by definition, a profound change of heart. It is a complete change of mind. It is a confession that you are indeed not on the right path. And the way that your natural compass, your moral compass, is leading you is not bringing you to heaven, but instead to damnation in the eyes of God. So imagine your life without Jesus, with no connection to the grace of God, but only to the perfection demanded by the law of God. That requires a change in course. And our sinful mortal nature isn't going to make that change, because our nature is really just baked into our DNA. We are the products of a world whose fallen principle is survival of the fittest. Matthew quotes the words of Isaiah, those words about the light shining on those who live in darkness, in order to set up the beginning of Jesus' ministry. The exposing light of God's law calls us to repent. And just like sleeping children, or adults for that matter, our natural inclination may be to bury our head in the darkness and hide from that glaring light. Because nobody ever feels comfortable having the light of the law shown upon their sinful lives. That's not exactly what this is. This is a dawning light. The light of Christ opens a new day. It's a new chapter in life. It's a new hope of a life that is not just better, but it is forever. Admitting that what's inside of us is faulty isn't easy. It's not natural. But Jesus bids us to do it. Not with threats or commands, but with his promise of cleansing your sinful nature, with his radiant grace. At some point, somebody is going to have to answer to God for your sins of selfishness. Somebody will have to pay for the iniquities of your ego-driven desires. Your sins of omission, your sins of commission, mortal sins, venial sins, sins of the flesh. We can name them, we can categorize them. But most importantly, we can repent of them. And Jesus is willing and able offload them from us and carry them to his cross on our behalf. So this call to repentance, it begins with the proclamation of God's holy law. In that law, we find warning, there's condemnation, there's call for action in order to change. None of that, of course, is the gospel. And many an exposed sinner will just recoil the shock of the world. But Jesus has come, and he's given us reason to repent with a newfound confidence. God doesn't just shine a light upon our dark misdeeds. He shines the light of his saving presence. And he doesn't just say, repent, but he also proclaims the kingdom of heaven is near. While those who refuse to repent will find it threatening to hear that God's kingdom is at hand, those who are looking for something, those who are looking for relief, those who are seeking a salvation, find the comfort of God's healing presence. The kingdom of heaven is at hand because the one who is sent from heaven to save us is with us. Jesus has come to bring forgiveness and healing and peace with God. Jesus is near, and he brings healing for the sick, relief for those who are afflicted. He frees those who are oppressed. This is the gospel. This is the good news. Here is the light to shine upon us who are dwelling in darkness, living sometimes at the fringe of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus came to take our darkness on himself. He's the one that became, in the end, the outcast. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, Isaiah tells us. He was the one forced to carry his cross and was crucified upon it. And he did all this knowingly, willingly, just as it was prophesied. And he did it for us. And there at Calvary, as in the middle of the day, darkness covered the land, all of our sins were laid on him, and he died to set us free. And his resurrection then shined the light of a new day and a new life for us all. And it's a life that gives us hope and brings us peace and invites us, come and repent. Because in Jesus' death and in his resurrection, we have the feeling that we need. The light of the gospel gives us hope and a reason that we can turn from our sins and live in them no longer. It shines the love of God that turns our hearts toward this God who offers us agape love. Toward our closest neighbors, it even turns us toward our enemies. For as Jesus brought healing, so this eternal life we have with him will do away with all diseases and infirmities. And as Jesus brought relief for those oppressed by demons in Galilee, so he relieves us by defeating the devil and sealing his fate. And as he healed the paralytics that were brought to him, so his gospel heals us from being paralyzed in our sins, and it inspires us to repent, and as we said this morning, to draw near with a true heart, to confess our sins to God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. Here on earth, it is the kingdom of repentance and forgiveness. Jesus is here to overcome the darkness of your life so that you can now walk in the light of his grace. Even to us, even if we're on the very fringe of the kingdom, like the lands of Zebulun and Naphtali were, Jesus has come to us all so that all might come out of the darkness and live in his light. Amen. Congregation, please stand if you are able as we sing the offer.
Divisions and quarreling,
whether by false teaching or cults of personality, deeds of Peter Sirocco, Robin Wall, Suzanne Clark, Ruth Eurostat, Marge Chenoweth, Adrian Sherman, Carol Moore, Lyle Weaver, A.J. McGraw, Roxanne Atkins, John Mitch, Barbara Reed, and Charlie Branch. And deliver them according to your gracious will. Lord, in your wisdom,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, your Son became famous as people witnessed his miracles and wonders. As he has wondrously saved us from sin and death, so open our mouths to speak of him to all who believe. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, we gratefully remember the sufferings and death of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, for our salvation. Rejoicing in his victory over death, we draw strength from his ascension before you, where he now stands as our high priest. Gather us together from the ends of the earth to celebrate in all of the faithfuls the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. For to you alone we give all glory, honor, and worship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
So
Amen.